I tell you the truth, anyone who gives you a cup of water in my name, because you belong to Christ, will certainly not lose his reward. A cup of cold water, something so small, something so seemingly insignificant, a very small, kind gesture, some tiny, offhanded blessing, and yet it is known as unto the Lord. It is done as unto the Lord, and there is a reward given by God. There is an acknowledgement and an understanding, and so much will depend on these small, offhanded, perhaps even casual acts of kindness. Just a cup of cold water, and who knows what might come of it. How lives might be changed, hearts might be blessed, souls might be saved. For there are no coincidences. I'm quite convinced of that. Your chance to be there, to be that one person with that cold cup of water at just the right time and in just the right place to quench the thirst of someone in need, doesn't happen coincidentally or from the convergence and confluences of stars and planets, but is a blessed gift and opportunity to be right where the Lord has put you. To be at that time, at that place, with that cup of water, so that His good will might be achieved. His plan might be met. No coincidences, just gracious gifts where we get to peek behind the curtain and see how God's plan connects us all. How those threads woven together in a magnificent tapestry that we couldn't even imagine. And for just that coincidental moment, we get to see how there really are no coincidences, just God's perfect and gracious will. And how for just a moment, we got to see it. We got to be a part of it. And so since there are no coincidences, I will take today's opportunity to have our reading from Esther to make sure that we all remember the story of Esther. Now, in our entire 3-year lectionary cycle, this is the only time that Esther gets read. Hey, no coincidences. This must be the time to talk about Esther. So let's talk about Esther. Deep within the Old Testament, it's a book that's not particularly long. It might not seem particularly significant. Relatively brief period of time that's covered over this one story. And yet, the book of Esther endures as a witness to God's faithfulness, His provision, and how He cares for the needs of His people, both small and large, both common and desperate. So the book of Esther, to give you the little reminder of background, is happening after the Babylonian captivity. The people of Israel have strayed and they have turned against God, and God allows the more powerful nations to conquer them and to carry them away. Well, nothing lasts forever, and though Babylon might have been on top of the heap, they're not top dog very long before a bigger, badder country comes through. This time, it is the Empire of Persia. And so Persia has come through and has knocked everybody else down. And a lot of the Jews who had been carried away in Babylonian captivity now find themselves as subjects to Persia. And that's where we find Mordecai, a faithful Jew who is living within these foreign lands under a foreign king, King Xerxes of Persia, and faithful Mordecai, who has taken his orphan cousin, Esther, and raised her as his own. Well, to put into perspective just how different it was to live in Persia than it was to live in Israel, we have a king within Persia of Xerxes who gets ticked off by his wife. She does something very simple and very small, but she's not around when he wants her to be around. He's throwing a big party. She's kind of petulant, and she doesn't come, and that's all it took. So Xerxes gets rid of his queen because she has displeased him. You can't have a kingdom without a queen, so what are we going to do? And they hatch this grand scheme. We're going to have a year-long competition to see who the next queen is going to be. It's like the ancient equivalent to American Idol, Persia style. And so the most beautiful young women are all gathered in. And for an entire year, they're made beautiful and they're offered all these lessons, and they compete against one another to see who will rise on top. Now Mordecai has entered Esther into this contest, but said, shh, don't tell anyone you're a Jew. We are strangers in a strange land, and people don't like us very much. You just keep it to yourself, keep your head down, and do your best. Well, she does, and she wins. Esther wins this year-long competition and becomes the new queen of Persia. Now Mordecai, who worked around the palace, just so happens to overhear a couple of guys talking about a plot to kill the king. Well, Mordecai happens to know somebody highly placed in the palace, so he tells Esther to tell the other people to protect the king, and the plot is discovered, and those guys are dealt with, and the king is saved. No one thinks much about it, and life just continues. Well, over this time of the past year or so of both the queenly competition and her settling into the royal court, there's been a new power that's risen up within the structure of the kingdom, and that is the general Haman. And Haman is quite a piece of work. He's apparently pretty good at what he does, but he really, really wants everybody to know how good at what he does. He's got this habit of when he walks around, he wants everyone to acknowledge his greatness. Bow down before me, because here comes Haman. And he legitimately expected everyone to bow down and offer him homage, even when he was just kind of walking down the street. Walking down the street in the middle of the square, he assumed everyone would not only know who, oh, Haman is so great and Haman is so wonderful, and what's that guy not bowing before me? Who would dare not bow before the greatness of Haman? It was Mordecai, the faithful Jew. Mordecai, as a faithful Jew, knew, I will bow to no one else other than God alone. I don't care who you are or what you can do to me. I am not going to worship you. To underscore the sort of crazy that Haman is, he was not only vindictively angry at Mordecai enough to want to kill him, he decided that the best thing to do was to kill all Jews everywhere. Because Mordecai wouldn't bow to him, I will exterminate them all, he says. So he takes these lots, like gambling dice, and he throws them out to pick a date. Whatever date they land on, circle it in the calendar, because that is doomsday for the Jews. And Haman was overjoyed at his plan. He was so looking forward to getting rid of Mordecai. He had this giant gallows built in his own front yard. Because he wanted Mordecai to not only die, he wanted to watch his body swing for days. You know, he's in the kitchen eating breakfast. He wants to look up and up. He's still dead. That's the kind of guy he was. So when I say he's a real piece of work, this is who we're talking about. So the word begins to spread. It's on the calendar, the day of doom, and all the Jews will die. So Mordecai goes once again to Esther. He says, Esther, you got to do something. You got to save us. You got to help us. You got to talk to the king. You have to stop this, Esther. And Esther says, are you crazy? You remember what happened to the last queen, right? And who was the one who told me to never mention that I was a Jew? You are asking me to commit suicide here. I'm going to go to the king and tell him to save us. You know what's going to happen? I'm going to be the one who pays for it. And Mordecai says, in the most famous verse within this book, if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you have not come to the kingdom for such a time as this. Mordecai says, God is going to save his people. He can do it with you, or he can do it without you. You stand with him, you will succeed. Because he will succeed. If you're frightened and you run away, you're going to lose it all. But God's good will is going to be done regardless. Who knows? Maybe this is why you are queen in the first place. Maybe this is why you won this competition. Maybe this is why you are who you are, when you are, where you are, for this moment, right here, right now. This is your opportunity. Stand with God and watch his will be done through you, or tuck your tail, run away, and watch his will be done in spite of you. Takes a deep breath. Screws up her courage. She hatches a plan. She goes to make an appeal to the king. To go make an appeal without first being summoned is to risk your own execution. But instead, the king receives her, and receives her gladly. Okay? So far, so good. Step one complete. She says, I would like to throw you this wonderful party, and I want all the important people to be there. Okay? So now Xerxes is happy. He's going to have this great party. And guess what? His loyal right-hand man, Haman, will be there too. Step two. It is now complete. Well, the night before the party, Xerxes can't sleep. Fighting off his insomnia, he decides the best thing to do is to go look through the history of his own kingdom and put himself to sleep. His own exploits will be so boring, I assume, that he will eventually fall back asleep. And as he's reading through, he's like, oh yeah, huh. I forgot all about that time that those people were going to kill me, and that guy, Mordecai, saved my life. Whatever happened to old Mordecai? And so we asked some folks, what did we ever do to repay this guy? They said, well, kid, we did nothing. What? We can't do that. You know what? My wife is throwing me this big party. Why don't you invite Mordecai? Why don't you make sure he's there? That'd be kind of a nice gesture. I mean, he did save my life after all. And so they have this big party, and there is the king, and there is the queen, there is Haman, and there is Mordecai. They're all there together. And this party goes great, and it's fantastic, and it's so good, the king is so impressed. He wants to bless his dear wife. Oh, beautiful Queen Esther. What would you like? What can I give you? Make any request that you would like, and I will grant it. And Esther said, what? You know, there's not really anything that I need. But if you could find a way for I and all of my people to not be murdered tomorrow, that would be super. And Xerxes says, what now? Well, you know, I'm a Jew, and all the Jews are scheduled to be executed on the same date, and it's on the calendar, it's like the doomsday for me and for all my people, and we're about to die, so, I mean, any chance you could save my life, that would be great. Who would dare raise his hand against my queen and her people? Who would have the gall? Who would have the temerity? What lowlife so-and-so would ever get it into his head? And Esther just goes, yeah. And the king just blows his staff. He's so mad and he's so full of rage, he actually leaves the room. And as soon as he leaves the room, Haman, who's been watching this whole time, going, he throws himself at the feet of Esther. Oh, please! You gotta save me! Have mercy! Have mercy! You just, oh, please, 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 Esther, 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 you can have mercy! And that's exactly when the king walks back in. And he sees Haman all over his wife, grabbing and pawing and begging, and he thinks that he's trying to attack her right here and right now in his own presence, and he says, and that's it. Grab him. Guards yank him away, and one of them says, well, you know, funny thing. Haman, would you believe, actually has this gigantic gallows built in his own front yard. And the king says, well, that's fantastic. Let's hang him on it. Yeah. Haman is hanged from his own gallows, the one that he had designed for Mordecai.
These are ours.
Xerxes says, this date that has been circled to kill all the Jews shall now be their day of triumph. Jews, anyone comes after you, you fight back. You have my blessing. And they do. They conquer their enemies. And the date that has been circled for their doom becomes a date of celebration. It becomes a date of joy. And from that day on, forevermore, every year, the Jews celebrate the feast of Purim. And they read this story. They feast, and they laugh, and they celebrate. Purim, after the lots that were cast to pick the date of their death that becomes the date of God's holy triumph. Because God's goodwill was going to be accomplished. His people were going to be saved. And Esther, through her courage, and Mordecai, through his faithfulness, were blessed to be a part of it. Few of us, I dare say, will ever stand in the halls of great power and beg for the deliverance of thousands of people. Few of us will have the opportunity to stand like Esther with great courage, with lives upon lives hanging in the balance. But maybe, just maybe, there will be someone who crosses your path who needs something far more simple than that. Perhaps as simple as a cup of cold water. And who knows? Maybe you are where you are. You are who you are. And with what you have for a time just such as that. For the Lord will carry out his goodwill. His people will be delivered, and they shall be saved. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, and he will not let his people down. But maybe, just maybe, you and I could get to be a part of it. Maybe, just maybe, through ways that are spectacular or ways that are just very simple, we might be a part of that godly care, of that divine provision, of the care, of the blessing, even the salvation of others. Acts that seem very small or even offhanded might echo through eternity. We don't know. We don't know. That small gesture of kindness might change a life. That small gesture of kindness that we could have done, but we averted our eyes and we walked on past, might echo as well. Few of us will stand with lives in the balance, but every single one of us will have times and places and people that the Lord desires to care for, to bless, and to even save. It is a godly and gracious gift to be used by him then to offer the care for those who are in need. For God's will shall be done. He will care for and deliver his people. He who is the maker of heaven and earth, he is our help. He is our stronghold. And he is our friend. Maybe, just maybe, you are where you are, when you are, who you are, and with what you've got, to be a part of that help, and a part of that care, and a part of that deliverance. No one knows what might be done through something small, through something simple, but something done in the name of Christ. For there are no coincidences. No coincidence that Persia needed a queen. No coincidence that Esther was the one who needed it. No coincidence that Mordecai overheard a plot. No coincidence that the king received Esther instead of punishing her, that all the people were in the right place at the right time to do the right thing. No coincidence that the method chosen for destruction becomes the method chosen for godly deliverance. The days of our death mark the moment of God's triumph. Just godly opportunities for us to peek behind the curtain, have a look through a crack in the doorway, and see how all those threads come together to weave a tapestry more beautiful than we can imagine. For God's goodwill shall be done. Faithfulness of Mordecai, perhaps the courage and bravery of Esther. Maybe you and I get to be part of it.